Get here and they like cooking. They like to be here. So that is a real blessing, and thank you for the privilege of being able to come and share with you this morning. Also, thank you for the privilege of being the Director of Missions for Kabai Baptist Association. It is a lot of fun, but it is a busy time. Every Sunday, I get to preach at least three times. When I took this position, I was worried about would I have opportunities to preach, and they're about to preach me to death now. But anyway, this weekend, we just got through doing our Wounded Warrior Deer Hunt. Had 15 veterans come in, Wounded Warriors, Purple Heart recipients. They deer hunted all over our county, but it wasn't about deer hunting. It was about meeting men where they are with the love of Christ. And a lot of these guys come in and they're suffering from various traumatic incidences and also, suffering from some bodily injuries as well. And we bring them in and minister to them. Last night at Silverina, we had a wild game supper. And boy, it was good. Had about over 300 people there and recognized these guys, and it was a wonderful occasion. We had all kinds of wild game. We had squirrels, and we had alligator, and we had deer. I don't know if we had any coon or possum or not. I didn't ask. I just ate what was before me and acted like it was good. That's what you're supposed to do, isn't it? So anyway, but we did have some good desserts and all. But anyway, I'm privileged to come and be with you this morning. I want you to take your Bibles and turn to the book of Joshua. We're just going to look at the first nine verses of chapter 1. But before we get into that, I do want to say this about Brother Jimmy. And the first time I met him was in the bank in Crystal Springs at the Regions Bank. And we were standing there and a wasp flew in the door and stung him right on top of his head. And you know, I was really impressed because that wasp stung the fire out of him. And he just smashed it and he didn't say an ugly word. And I said, pretty good fella right here. And then he became your pastor out here. What a wonderful pastor, what a wonderful few years that he was here with you, nine of those years. And that's probably me doing all that fooling around up here. But anyway, what a blessing it is. You know, when you lose a leader like that, or a leader moves on in God's will, you find yourself really kind of in a vacuum. And you wonder what's going to happen next. And that's the situation that we find in Joshua chapter 1. Moses, God's servant, had passed from the scene, and now it was Joshua's turn to take the reins of leadership and move the people forward into the promised land. What an awesome responsibility that was. But God gave some wonderful advice to Joshua, and that's what we read in chapter 1. Now it came about after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' servant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise and cross this Jordan, all you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the sons of Israel. Every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given to you, just as I spoke to Moses. From the wilderness of this Lebanon, even as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, as far as the great sea, toward the setting of the sun, will be your territory. Look at verse 5. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you. I will not fail you nor forsake you. Isn't that great? God's promise here. I will not fail you or forsake you. Verse 6. Be strong and courageous, for I shall give this people possession of the land which I swore to their fathers to give to them. Only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, so that you may have success wherever you go. Verse 8 is the key to success. And he says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed. For the Lord your God will be with you forever, wherever you go. Did you notice that just reading this very quickly? Did you notice how many times God said to Joshua, only be strong and very courageous, for I will be with you wherever you go. God just kept emphasizing that to Joshua. And there's a reason for that. Think about the responsibility that Joshua had placed upon his shoulders. Moses was a great leader. And you read the story of Moses and you realize that God had his hand on Moses. His life was divided into three parts. The first 40 years, he learned the wisdom of Egypt as Pharaoh's son, or Pharaoh's daughter's son. And then the next 40 years, he was in the wilderness of Midian. You remember he had to flee from Egypt because he had killed the Egyptian, and he knew that his life was on the line. He fled to Midian, and there in Midian, he was a shepherd out in the wilderness, and God was teaching him the ways of the wilderness. And even in his failure, God was preparing Moses to be a successful leader. Then the last 40 years, he went back to Egypt and led the children of Israel out of Egypt. He was 80 years old when God started using him. Don't use your age as an excuse. God can take anybody who's available and use them to his glory. But Moses was a great leader and servant of the Lord. He had a humble heart. As a matter of fact, he was the most humble man perhaps who lived other than our Lord Jesus Christ, who humbled himself and went to the cross and died for our sins. And so Moses was a great leader. And all of a sudden, Moses is gone. And God says to Joshua, Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. Yes, there's a glorious past here. And you can celebrate the past and you can live in the past, but that's not what God wants. God wants us to take what we've learned from the past and apply it to the future and then follow him faithfully. And God said to Moses, or to Joshua, Moses is dead. Now it's your turn. And so you're going to lead this people across the Jordan to inherit the promised land. Now think about that. Here is Joshua assuming the role of leadership after following a great leader. That is a tough position. And so as he looks at this and God speaks to him, God makes him a promise. And he says, Joshua, just as I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. Do you realize that our Lord is absolutely faithful? Amen. And God was saying to him, to Joshua, I am going to be faithful to you. Just like I was faithful in my promise and keeping my promises to Moses, I'm going to keep my promises. I'm going to be faithful to you. I learned a great lesson here about 3 years ago about God's faithfulness. I've been going to Cuba for 7 years now, and every May I go down to Cuba and spend about 10 days working with the churches in Cuba. I never thought I would go to Cuba. As a matter of fact, I grew up in the panhandle of Florida, right at the east gate of Eglin Air Force Base. When I was a kid, they had what was called the Cuban Missile Crisis, and we thought Cuba was going to wipe us off the map. As a matter of fact, we had nuclear drills in school, just like a tornado drill. And they would ring the bell and they'd say, close the curtains, get under your desk, and put your head between your knees and get ready for the nuclear blast. And we were going to survive it by doing that. Wow. They didn't tell us kids everything we needed to know. But the experience I had with Cuba, the thought I had with Cuba, these folks are our enemies. I went to Cuba for the first time. I met some of the most wonderful Christian people I've ever been around. We have a seminary in Santiago, Cuba. I get to teach there. I get to preach and be with those pastors. One of my dear pastor friends is Argelio Sanchez from Santiago, Cuba. He's been here to visit me 3 times, been in my home, he and his wife, and wonderful Christian people. I found God at work. Pastor Alex pastors at El Cobre, and one day he said to me, Stan, I want you to go with me up into the mountainous regions. There's a pastor up there that I want you to meet. And so we drove as far as we could, and we got up to where, close to where we were going, had to park the car and walk the rest of the way. And we finally got up on the side of this mountain, and there was a thatch church there made out of sticks and banana leaf, just a stick church there. And there was a pastor there. And I got to meet that pastor, incredible person, loved the Lord. And I was sitting there talking to him, and I said, "Tell me what you need. Tell me what you need." And he said to me, we need $600 to be able to rebuild our church. $600 to rebuild our church. Now I want you to get this in perspective. This man makes less than $8 a month. So when he said we need $600 to rebuild our church, it might as well have been $6 million. Because you think about people that make less than $30 a month, and that's what they live on, and this pastor was making about $8 a month, so it was an impossible situation. How in the world are they going to get $600? And I said to myself, I can get $600. So I came back to Crystal Springs, and I told the kids in the church about it, and they decided in Vacation Bible School that they would collect the money to rebuild this church down in Cuba. And so they did a great job. They not only collected $600, they collected $1,500. Isn't that amazing? So a bunch of kids heard God speak to them, and they took it on as a project for Vacation Bible School. And then I got to go back to Cuba, and I had the money in my pocket that the pastor needed to rebuild his church. So on a Wednesday, my brother Alex and I made our way back up to that little church, stuck off in the middle of nowhere. Kind of like some of these places in Mississippi, where nowhere meets nothing, just holding the world together. We went up there, and I didn't know, but the pastor had changed. There was a new pastor at this church. He had no idea whatsoever about any previous conversations that I had with him, with the other pastor. He had no clue about anything. He didn't know about me talking about what the church needed or what he needed. It was a brand new guy. I got up there and I was surprised. This is not the same pastor. And Pastor Alex began to talk to this pastor, and he introduced me. This is Brother Stan, all the way from Mississippi. He's come down here to minister with us and to help us. And I got to talk to that pastor. I said, "Tell me what you need." Before he told me what he needed, he pointed to a place in the church. It's a concrete slab now with just a thatch roof and walls made out of sticks around it. And it was a well-worn place. You could tell that somebody had spent some time over there because that concrete was slick. And he told me, he said, "That's where I pray. I've been praying every day that somehow God would provide for us to be able to rebuild this church. Hurricane Sandy destroyed our other church, and I've been praying every day, and I pray right there to hide from my two boys because they'll interrupt me, and I've been praying over there every day that God would somehow give us the resources that we needed." I was sitting there with the resources in my pocket. And then I said, "What do you need?" He said, "We need $600 to be able to rebuild this church." And I'll tell you what happened. I said, "Brother, God's answered your prayer." And I pulled out that $600 and gave it to him. Mm-hmm. Tears started streaming down his face, and this is what he did. He said, "Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me." Amen. His wife came in there. She wept. The boys wept. They hugged. They hugged me like to squeeze life out of me. But I made me realize something. If God could answer a pastor's prayer in the remotest place I've ever been in my life, in Cuba, could be working in his life and at the same time working in the life of a bunch of children in Crystal Springs, Mississippi, and God can make the connection and bring the two together and meet the need. I'm telling you, God is faithful and he can meet every need that we have in our lives. Amen. God said to Joshua, I am faithful and I will be with you wherever you go. And God is with us now. Do you realize that Hopewell Baptist Church belongs to Jesus? Amen. You believe that you're God's people and that God's going to take care of you? You better believe it. You believe that God's got a pastor out there he's going to bring and going to bless the socks off of you? Amen. You better believe it, because God is absolutely faithful and he's got his hand on this church. And as he was with you in the past, he's with you in the present. He will be with you in the future. You can trust him. Don't you doubt him. He is absolutely faithful. So he said to Joshua, as I have been with Moses, I'm going to be with you. Now here's your responsibility, he said. Only be strong and very courageous, because I will be with you wherever you go. He said, take courage. Take courage. Keep your eyes on me. Do you realize that's where courage comes from? Courage comes from putting our eyes on the Lord and realizing that he is able, that our God is able to do all things, and nothing is impossible with him. So he says, I'm going to be with you, so your job is you be strong and you be courageous and you trust me. He said, as I have been faithful to you, you be faithful to me. This verse, verse 8, is one of the most important verses in the Old Testament, where God said to Joshua, here's your key to success. He said, this book of the law that I have given, probably referring to Deuteronomy, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. You're to meditate on it day and night, and you're to be careful to do all that is written therein, and then I'll make your way prosperous, and then I will make your way successful. Do you realize that God measures success not by nickels and noses? God measures success not by the standards that we measure for success. God measures success by our faithfulness to him.
Amen.
When I was at First Baptist Church, we talked through the book of Jeremiah. I said through the book, I got 31 chapters, and it was 2.5 years and 600 pages of notes later. I was at chapter 31, and the folks looked at me and said, can we take a little break from Jeremiah? And I wished I hadn't listened to them, and I would have finished it. Now I got to still finish the task. But you know that Jeremiah was a great prophet of God, and Jeremiah preached for 23 years before the Babylonians came in and destroyed the nation of Judah. Preached for 23 years, and he was faithful to God, and for 23 years, nobody listened. For 23 years, they belittled him. They threw him in a pit. They put him in the stocks. They did everything they could to cause him to shut his mouth. But he did not. He continued to proclaim God's word. And for 23 years, nobody responded. Except with negative criticism. For 23 years, nobody walked the aisle. For 23 years, nobody made a recommitment. For 23 years, the waters of baptism were not stirred. For 23 years, by the world standards, everybody would say, that was the worst pastor, that was the worst preacher there ever was. But God looked at him and said, Jeremiah, I've called you to be faithful. And in the midst of great opposition, he remained faithful to God. And God was saying to Joshua, your success is not dependent on your ability. It's dependent on my faithfulness. And you be faithful to me. And you know, that's where we are in it. The church is in transition. It's a big transition. Your pastor's been here for 9 years. A great pastor, great leader. I love him. And still do. And God's going to continue to use him as he moves forward in evangelism. That's his heart. I always count on Brother Jimmy to preach a powerful message, and people respond to the gospel. But I want you to know your responsibility now in this time of transition is to be faithful. You be faithful to God's call in your life. You be faithful to the ministry of this church. You roll up your sleeves and you take responsibility and you serve the Lord and you keep your eyes on Him and be strong and courageous and do His will and His work, and His will and His work will go forward, and it's going to be okay, because when God brings a leader here, He will come into a church of prepared people and He will be blessed beyond measure because of your faithfulness to God. Isn't God good? Amen. I love that. The moment ago when we honored the man who these flowers are in memory of, I was so blessed, because I love that. God is good all the time. All the time. God is good. Amen. So God says to us, be strong and courageous. Be faithful, for I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you wherever you go. Now let's make a little personal application here for a moment. You're here this morning, and you might be going through a time of difficulty in your life. You know, I found out through the years that in every pew there's a broken heart. In every life there is a great need. And whatever it is in your life that's going on, and everybody has an it. And whatever it is that you might be dealing with personally in your life, I want you to know this. Our God is faithful.
Amen.
He'll meet the need in your life. And God will make a way when there seems to be no way. And if God can move in the heart of a Cuban pastor and a bunch of kids and meet the need and bring that connection together, God can do the same thing in your life. Don't you doubt Him. You trust Him. And you be faithful in the place where God has placed you. Trust Him. Only be strong and very courageous. Why? Because God has promised what? I'll be with you wherever you go. I'll not leave you nor forsake you. Let's pray.